He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the last day upon the earth. And though this body be destroyed, yet shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not as a stranger. I welcome you to this memorial service for our friend and colleague, F. Washington Jarvis, and call upon my colleague, D. Greg Sterling, to say a few words to welcome us again.
Thank you, Andrew. Please be seated. On behalf of Yale Divinity School and Yale University more widely, it is a pleasure to welcome you to this service in memoriam of the Reverend F. Washington Jarvis III, or as most of us knew him, Tony. Educated at Harvard and Cambridge in the Episcopal Theological School, Tony had distinguished careers in two places. Following a short period of service as a priest and educator in his native Cleveland, at the ripe old age of 28, he was appointed the 10th headmaster of Roxbury Latin School in Boston. He led the school for 30 years and transformed an institution with a high student attrition rate to a school where he, in his words, could honestly say, every boy is known and loved. At his death, the Roxbury Latin School announcement called him the most significant figure in the school's fourth century. When Adrian and I arrived at his funeral service almost 45 minutes early, the only place left to sit was in pews back in the entryway. Tony not only knew and loved the students of Roxbury Latin, they knew and loved him. The second major contribution he made was to the Elm program here on this campus. He arrived as the founding director in 2008 and remained until health issues forced his retirement in 2016. Tony helped make it possible to offer students at Yale Divinity School the opportunity to pursue careers as educators and administrators in private schools across the country, not only schools in formation with Berkeley, but all Yale Divinity School students. He was insistent on quality and personal integrity, characteristics that gave the Elm program a solid foundation. Passionate in his care for students, he also understood what it took to run an institution or a program. I will always remember some of the things that he said to me when there were crises in the school. They were said with conviction and articulated in unforgettable, earthy language. Most of you know my code there. I appreciated his wisdom immensely. Tony was also generous to programs, perhaps to a fault. Dean McGowan and I had more than one conversation in which we wondered if we would have to argue with him to accept a raise. One of the few people in all of my years as being a dean that I've had to worry about. We hope that through this service, Tony will know that just as the students of Roxbury Latin knew and loved him, so do we. And now we honor Tony's request that his funeral be about God rather than about Tony, and we turn to God in worship.
Thank you.
cannot be numbered. Accept our prayers on behalf of thy servant Tony, and grant him an entrance into the land of light and joy in the fellowship of thy saints. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all the people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the Gospel according to Mark. People were bringing little children to Jesus in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and bless them. The word of the Lord.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I don't think I will shock this company if I make the gentle suggestion that Tony Jarvis was something of a contrarian, and often in ways that were worth paying attention to. One of them, or perhaps more than one, was indeed manifest in his funeral last October, where a few of you, at least, I know, were present. Tony was old enough, you see, to remember when funerals, not least Anglican ones, did not have eulogies, nor were they, quote, celebrations of life, unquote, as is now so often the case, whether in name only or even sometimes in reality, but rather were occasions of sober reflection and prayer. His own funeral was hence a requiem mass, one where the congregation is bidden to pray for the departed, and that is their main job. His homilist was under strict instructions not to eulogize. In fact, that preacher disobeyed, although Providence, or perhaps Tony might have suggested the intercession of Our Lady, ensured that the homilist, as a result, was unable to be physically present, and the sermon turned eulogy was read by somebody else. Now, these choices did not just reflect Tony's liturgical conservatism, undoubted as it was. They were a statement. They were a statement about death and a statement about life. In the Eucharistic prayer of the Requiem Mass of both the Roman Catholic Church and of the Episcopal Church is this line: "To your faithful people, Lord, life is changed, not ended. When the body of our earthly dwelling lies in death, there is prepared for us a dwelling place eternal in the heavens." And what strikes me as interesting about this and about Tony's clear choices, those honoured and those dishonoured, is that while the contemporary tendency to have celebrations of life are inevitably retrospective, that the theological direction in which the Requiem Mass looks is forward rather than backward. Tony made the simple and confronting claim in the arrangements for his funeral that what he needed most was not to be remembered and celebrated, but for the church militant and triumphant to pray for him now. Now, I have to acknowledge in this ecumenical and indeed historically Protestant context that that idea is not without controversy, even for Anglicans. Most of us had eschewed prayer for the dead at the Reformation and only returned to it with characteristic lack of enthusiasm, of course, and only returned to it in the last century and a half as Catholic principles began to revive within the Church of England and within this church and other parts of the Anglican Communion, but also because in that same period of time, the world began to deal with different experiences of death. And it's often suggested that the enormous losses of life in the Civil War in this country and in the Great War in Europe gave rise to different ways of thinking among the faithful members of the church about how the dead should be remembered. But it's true in any case that certain experiences of death, disaster, and war, even those which are locked up within the battlegrounds of our individual lives, can shake the foundations of any neat Calvinistic formulation about grace, election, and providence. Now, I have referred and will refer one or two more times to Tony today, and there will be other remembrances which we have already heard and which we will hear later in this time today as well. But I want to note, and I'm saying this in case he's listening as well, that this is not a eulogy. And I mean it. This is a sermon. And this, I think, is what Tony would have asked, not that he be remembered except before God, and not that we give thanks for a life past without praying for his and our peace and joy in the future. But I think that this recognition sheds an interesting light upon the life that we, of course, remember with thanks when we consider Tony today. Tony's work here at Yale, as well as for three decades at Roxbury Latin before this, was that of a teacher, as well as being here to work with those who would be teachers, and we cannot but remember him so. At Roxbury Latin particularly, he held together what for most people is surely a remarkable tension, almost a unique tension, held together almost by the sheer force of his personality, between an unapologetic Anglo-Catholic clerical identity and his leadership of an institution whose Anglican connections were as ancient as they were limited, and whose students were as likely to be Jewish, Catholic, or irreligious as they were Episcopalian, and yet every day it was Father Jarvis and clericals. What sense does this make, other than the sense of this particular remarkable individual who we remember? Well, he's not the only person that many of us know who's both ordained and a teacher or something like that, right? And there are those who manage such combinations by benign compartmentalization. There's nothing inimical, of course, between the ideas of being a priest and a teacher. But was Tony just a priest who happened to be a great educator? Or conversely, was he one of those incidentally ordained teachers? Or was this something else? Was this some kind of synthesis, a kind of priesthood, a form of pedagogy? A number of the ancient theologians, among whom I probably spend all too much of my own time, the so-called fathers of the church, people like Clement of Alexandria, his compatriot Origen, the great Augustine of Hippo, were explicit about the fact that the reason we have human life is because it's a program of pedagogy, a curriculum provided by God for our recalcitrant selves in order to teach us the things we need to know in order to have the life that will succeed this one. In this view, our lives as we currently know them are certainly not ends in themselves, but primarily experiences of learning and discipline and correction whose purpose is to fit us for another life. Some of those same Christian teachers and others since observed that life as we know it does not always seem to be completely adequate, pedagogically speaking. Sometimes it's just too short. Sometimes it's not lived under conditions of love and beauty and justice, such that we might learn everything that God wants us to know about what life should really be. And so they thought of death not so much as the end of school, but as graduation to another grade, promotion to a different kind of institution, where the experience of learning how to love and live adequately would continue with even greater effectiveness. This, of course, was the core story, the basic narrative underlying Tony's faith, but also Tony's work, up to and including that requiem. But it also sheds particular light, I think, on his vocation and that which we share in this place. No, Tony was not a priest who just had a job as a headmaster. No, Tony was not just a teacher who happened to be ordained. He understood not only that every priest is a teacher, which may come readily to mind, but this more striking claim, that every teacher is a priest. As headmaster, Tony was not distracted by the ubiquitous narratives now abroad of education merely as preparation for job readiness or as gearing up for material wealth and security. Education for Tony was the inculcation of virtue. And while this notion of the virtues has cross-cultural and perennial force and is not simply something which a Christian might hold, For Tony, this was not about virtue for its own sake. For Tony, the God of Jesus Christ was the source of all love and wisdom, and Christ always the true teacher. Education is not preparation for employment, it's preparation for eternity. Every headmaster is indeed a priest, although some may serve other gods. As we consider his life with gratitude, Tony would, I think, offer us, both in his example and in his own words, if we were able to hear them, both holy encouragement for our own work, but also a measure of discomfort. Our work here is not merely an ecclesiastical version of the job readiness narrative. Rather, we believe that we equip people for effective leadership in schools, as in churches, not because they gain accreditation here, but because they might be schooled for virtue here. And so our work of pedagogy in this divinity school is not something that can just be mapped onto the course of a life well lived or worth eulogizing or celebrating purely in retrospect. It is a stage in the forming of human life for life with God, as well as the training of those who are called to form others in their life with God, future as well as present. And that, of course, is also the work for which we equip the students whom we send out from the Educational Leadership and Ministry Program to work in schools and other communities. This is privileged work, but it's urgent work too. So for Tony, school is out, but I think he would have assured us that the real school's really just begun. The theologian Ben Myers puts it this way: even the profoundest scholars are like children learning the alphabet. But one day, we shall step through the doorway into that big, bright classroom, and we will finally learn to read. Rest eternal grant to our brother Tony and all the faithful departed, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon them. Amen. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Tony, and dry the tears of those who weep. Hear us, Lord. You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. Hear us, Lord. You raised the dead to life. Give to our brother everlasting life. Hear us, Lord. Our brother was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give him fellowship with all your saints. Hear us, Lord. He was nourished with your body and blood. Grant him a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. Hear us, Lord. Encourage us by his example in our work with those who teach and those who learn. Hear us, Lord. May your teaching always guide and shape us and our teachers and students. Hear us, Lord. Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our brother Tony. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who rose victorious from the dead and comforts us with the blessed hope of everlasting life. Amen. We'll sing, Ye Watchers and Ye Holy Ones.
Thank you. remembering Father Tony. Father Tony is one of those people you'll never forget. His twinkling blue eyes remind you of a mischievous schoolboy and someone who is filled with the Holy Spirit. He was the epitome of a spiritual being, full of grit, integrity, and tremendous love for his students. I was fortunate to have taken one of his last classes here at Yale Divinity in leadership ministry in schools. He taught us well, specifically how to be chaplains in religious independent schools and how to stay focused and God-centered in all we do. Lively conversations ensued in the classroom, and sometimes he even played the devil's advocate. That helped us stay true to our convictions. Convictions such as bringing God to life in this world, walking with Jesus as our companion, and asking the Holy Spirit to guide us. He helped us to focus and stay our true north through the next journey of our lives. He was quirky, and at times I think some of the students didn't know how to take Father Tony. For me, I understood his quirkiness and I loved it. He was real, the real deal in today's world. He helped me discern deeper into my own spirituality and how I can bring spirituality to students, simply by being who I am and who God called me to be. In his words, he taught us, teachers have to be boldly countercultural. We have only two weapons we can bring to the battle of winning kids over, love and prayers. In my experience, strong and persistent love has the power to transform even the toughest and seemingly most unreachable student. This statement of his rings true in my position as director of campus ministry, chaplain, and religion teacher at Laurelton Hall in Milford, which is an all-girls independent Catholic high school. And it was founded by the Sisters of Mercy. In the fall of 2016, I reconnected with Father Tony here at his honorary degree ceremony. I shared with him my plans of Laurelton's first domestic mission immersion trip to the native Navajo Nation in Tehachapi, New Mexico, and the Kairos retreat I had planned. He said to me, "Gene, you are bringing God to Laurelton Hall." That's when I realized how God was at work through me and I was helping students find their way through love and prayer. During my years at Yale Divinity, I consulted with Father Tony about the path I should take. I was discerning to stay Catholic or become Episcopalian and seek ordination. He said, "Gene, the Episcopalians would love to have you, but the Catholics need you more." His words were validation to my discerning heart. After all, we talked about this. How could this Italian-American Catholic, whose devoutly religious grandmother who walked 1 mile to 6 a.m. Mass every day, turn and become Episcopalian? He made me realize how deep my faith is rooted in me because of my grandmother. Almost, though, more importantly, Father Tony was aware how the Catholic Church needs more women to be involved in the spiritual and administrative life of the church. In class, Father Tony told us many, many stories about his time as headmaster at Roxbury Latin. He was passionate about the importance of the headmaster and chaplain working in tandem to bring God to the students. He said, "Getting into college has become the real religion of many religiously affiliated prep schools. I'm interested in getting students into heaven, not Harvard." And this excerpt from Psalm 119, I think this, he mentioned in one of our classes, how we can understand how the countercultural teacher needs to boldly face the world today. How can young people keep their way pure? by guarding it in according to your word. With my whole heart I seek you. Do not let me stray from your commandments. I treasure your word in my heart so that I may not sin against you. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. With my lips I declare all the ordinances of your mouth. I delight in the way of your decrees as much as in all riches. I will meditate on your precepts and fix my eyes on your ways. I will delight in your statutes. I will not forget your word. Teachers have to be boldly countercultural. Father Tony, you taught us well. You advised me well. It is with heartfelt gratitude and love that I boldly embrace these countercultural words to teach the conviction of Jesus' own teaching of love. With love and prayers to you, Father Tony, continue to pray for us.
Good afternoon. My name is Jerry Wells. It is my good fortune and humbling opportunity to succeed Father Tony Jarvis in the work of directing the Educational Leadership and Ministry Program here. Tony, I met all of maybe six times, and in those six times, my life was changed. So I envy those people who had that amount of time with him, as you did, Gene. Thank you so much for being with us today. As we know, as we've heard, before he came to Berkeley to establish ELM, the Educational Leadership and Ministry Program, Father Jarvis was for 30 years the headmaster of the venerable Boston Boys School, Roxbury Latin. This priest educator was as wholly dedicated to moral and spiritual edification as to the pursuit of intellectual excellence. In fact, for him, there was no difference. So he believed in the salutary benefits of weekly addresses to his students. And toward the end of his tenure, the best of his addresses were published in the collection With Love and Prayers, A Headmaster Speaks to the Next Generation. The book has had a remarkably expansive following for the past 18 years. Roxbury Latin graduates report using it with their corporate boards. Tony's professional circle, reflected in the leadership, his presidency of both the Headmasters Association and the Country Day School Headmasters Association, his colleagues in those groups have made extensive use of the book. One public school superintendent wrote, "This is a classic. I hope that it never goes out of print." It is, to use a biblical reference that this audience will appreciate, wisdom literature. Mixing personal anecdotes with straightforward advice, Jarvis would exhort his boys to be their very best. Some of the counsel was familiar, time-tested wisdom. Stop, look, and listen. Reach out for what lasts. Don't let yourself off the hook. But much of the addresses consisted of the kind of paradoxical but pithy truths that then Harvard chaplain Peter Gomes called Jarvis's uncommon common sense. And those of you who knew, loved, and respected Father Jarvis, you recognize that he loved being uncommon. So here are a few gems from With Love and Prayers.
Love is intolerant. It risks unpopularity and unpleasantness to do the right thing. Manners are unnatural. There is no getting around it. Manners are an unnatural truth. They involve an unnatural limiting of our natural self. Unnatural curbing of our rights. Manners are the most rudimentary way in which we acknowledge the existence of others in the curb our natural selfish instinct. Moderation in all things, I submit to you that the famous description of hellfire is bad advice. If you want to live a life of comfortable mediocrity, by all means live by the motto of hellfire. If you want a boring life, at the end of which you can look back at nothing more than having existed safely and comfortably, then by all means be excessive in nothing and moderate in all things.
Only a few in every generation overcome the self-centered orientation that dominates every age and come to see those around them as their brothers and sisters. The prospect of death brings perspective, conveys what Albert Camus calls a divine irresponsibility. We suddenly see how small our world is, and we suddenly realize the unimportance of all the things we consider so important. I pray that in your lives, you will dare to have high hopes, not only in your relationships with others, but in what you do in your lives. Cast fear aside. Let your hope be divinely irresponsible.
As this last passage indicates, perhaps the most challenging wisdom that Father Jarvis impressed upon his young charges is the importance of living purposefully in the full knowledge of the inevitability of death and in the full knowledge of the resurrection through our Lord Jesus Christ. It is clear that he lived his life that way. And it is fitting that here, in a memorial to that life, we reflect on how Father Jarvis regarded mortality. He shared with his students Dietrich Bonhoeffer's poem, written from his prison cell, whose lines serve as a fitting epitaph not only to Bonhoeffer, but also to this faithful servant, Tony Jarvis. Father, grant to the souls thou hast been chastening what thou hast promised, the healing and the cure. Should it be ours to drain the cup of grieving, even to the dregs of pain at thy command, we will not falter, thankfully receiving all that is given by thy loving hand. Today, let candles shed their radiant greeting. Lo, on our darkness are they not thy light, leading us happily to our longed-for meeting. Thou canst illumine even our darkest night.
Thanks.
faith and fear, for the Blessed Virgin Mary, for the holy patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and for all other thy righteous servants, known to us and unknown. And we beseech thee that, encouraged by their examples, aided by their prayers, and strengthened by their fellowship, we also may be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, through the merits of thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Rest eternal grant to Tony, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon him. May his soul and the souls of all the departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. Amen. Would you be seated for a moment, please? Before we go, I wanted to thank you all for joining us here today. And I know a number of you have traveled quite some distance to be here. It's wonderful to see a number of Tony's former students, members of the Yale Divinity School community. But I want in particular to welcome on all our behalf Tony's relatives, Craig, Ned and Cricket Smith. Thank you for being with us today. This means a great deal to us to have you in our midst. Thank you. I thought you would be intrigued to know where that last hymn came from. This was the work of Robert Panoia, MDiv 2015, who was an Elm graduate, who is now deputy head at the Grace School in New York City. And Robbie wrote this hymn at the time of Tony's however manyth retirement that was from here. And we were pleased to be able to use it today. And he's among a number who sent their apologies, but you can see what a wonderful tribute that was from Robbie. I also want to thank a number of people who have enabled us to be together to pray and worship, to Aaron Tan, our accompanist, to Patrick Keither, who helped very much with the order of service, and to the chapel ministers and Berkeley staff who've enabled this to come together at a busy time. And we hope that you will not flee away if you do not need to, but join us for a reception afterwards, which, now someone wave at me madly if this is wrong, in the old common room. Is that correct? Yes. The old common room, if you're not familiar with it, is down the stairs to the right, but you will, I'm sure, find a group of others who will join you and help you find the way if you don't know it, but please join with us. Finally, I want to share with you one important piece of news, which is a matter for celebration, I think, that just as we found it worth remembering Tony, not only for his sake, but perhaps even more for the sake of those things which he held dear, the Board of Trustees of Berkeley Divinity School at its last meeting agreed to establish the F. Washington Jarvis Fund for Educational Leadership to establish an endowment to support the ongoing work of the Elm program that Tony established here. And this was the most fitting way that we could honor his legacy. So I'm pleased to be able to share that news with you as we seek to celebrate Tony, not only in our prayers and words today, but in our actions as we go from this place as well. Would you stand? The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.